Welcome, everybody. My name is Jason MacCannell, and I'm Assistant Director of the California Research Bureau here at the State Library. And this is the first of a series of events that we're planning. We call it the Open Question Series, in which experts on topics of great relevance to the current policy discussions in the state of California will meet and share their learning with an audience of policymakers, stakeholders, and other interested members of the public. Today's event was made possible by generous donations from the Mohanna family and Poverty Matters, so let's all take a minute to thank them right now. They bought the food that you're eating, so very, very important to be thankful. We have some really interesting guests here today to talk about homelessness. Tom Byrne came to us all the way from Boston. He's a professor of social policy at Boston University and an author of many of the studies that we look at when we examine the evidence base for Housing First programs. Susie Shannon's joining us all the way from Los Angeles, a little bit closer than Boston, but still a hike. We're really happy to have her here today. She's not only one of our funders, she's also one of our presenters today. She's been the driving force, or one of the driving forces, in bringing Housing First to the awareness and the attention of policymakers here in California. She's going to kick off the program today talking about what the state of Utah did to end chronic homelessness, which is something that a lot of people in other states, especially here, have been looking at and paying attention to. We have Steve Waters, anthropology instructor at Los Rios, who also heads up a nonprofit for homeless people called First Step Communities. Steve has a really fascinating story to tell about working first as a researcher, as an anthropology graduate student, and then as an activist and a leader with the homeless autonomy movement here in Sacramento, and how that evolved into his current project to find a better solution for crisis homelessness. And finally, our own Shahar Hyatt, director of the California Homeless Youth Project here at the library, is going to talk to us about homeless youth, the last group of people, by the way, that we ever want to see becoming chronically homeless, and her own participation in host housing as an innovation, a solution for youth that's new and innovative. And as I mentioned before, we also have a special guest that we're expecting, and I'm going to let Susie introduce him when he arrives. The other people whose generosity helped make this event possible include Karen and Nellie. You can see them in the back. There are summer interns at the California Research Bureau. I couldn't have done this without them, as well as the library and Library Foundation staff that really went above and beyond to make this happen. This is my first event, so I did need a lot of help. Vince Beiderbecke, our videographer, currently back at the cameras. He's recording this, so the recording will be available, and also we do intend to make a written proceedings that will be sometime later this summer published by the Research Bureau. I'd also like to thank Public Information Officer Kim Brown, who I don't think is here right now, but did a lot, and Marta Knight, our foundation administrator, who was extremely helpful in getting this event off the ground. So before we get to the meat of it, a little bit of housekeeping. We know it's a busy time of year for a lot of you, so if you need to leave, just please do so quietly. We've scheduled a full hour for open discussion at the end of this event. If you can't stay, but if you have questions that you want addressed, you can find one of our interns, and she will take that question, she'll write it down, and the question will be asked in your absence. What else? Restrooms are right next door. Men's that way, women's that way, I think. Women's that way, men's that way. I'm backwards here. I think you can find it. And yes, I think that's about all. When you signed in, you had an opportunity to check a box on the sign-in sheet that will put your email address on a list of people who will receive notification when the video and when the proceedings are available. So I recommend that you either email me or you go back to the list and check that box if you want that and you didn't check the box on the way in. So I think that's all the housekeeping I need to do. Unless there are any quick questions from the audience, I'm going to begin with some introductory remarks. Okay. So it's time to talk about homelessness. Full disclosure, this is an important topic to me. Before joining state government, I spent almost all my adult life studying homelessness in one way or another. I cut my teeth as a researcher working on the local censuses that HUD, the Federal Department of Housing and Urban Development, uses to allocate continuum of care money to counties. I wrote my doctoral dissertation on homelessness. I worked on a grant with the University of Hawaii to conduct what I believe to be a unique study of homeless people's political opinions, which finally yielded its first publication last year. My career took a different direction from academic research, and now I work in a library. I love working in a library. Libraries are one of my favorite kinds of institution that exist. And as we gather here in the library to talk about homelessness, I think an important thing to mention is the prominent role that public libraries have come to play in the lives of homeless people, and also the prominent role that homeless people have come to play in the lives of public libraries. Because nearly anywhere you go today, you find homeless people in the public library. This building is no exception. This building is a public library, and there are homeless people here, maybe every day, I'm not sure. The simple sort of flat-footed explanation for why there are always homeless people in the public library is simple. It's the library is a place to go. Homeless people don't have a place to go. You can go to the library. Everyone can go to the library. That's what the library is for. It has seating and bathrooms. The library does. Every library has those things. These are amenities that have largely disappeared from the rest of urban space, in part because those spaces are trying to repel or not attract homeless people. Libraries climate controlled. You were all outside a minute ago, you're now inside. If you didn't have other places to be inside, this building would be very attractive to you. So just as a library is no more designed to be a day shelter for the homeless than a freeway overcrossing is designed to be a rainproof, sun-shaded campground, either one of these things can be made to function as such with very, very little effort. So, you know what? I'm going to cut myself off right here, maybe resume with a couple of other comments later, but Susie, why don't you come up here and do the introduction?
Hi, I'm Susie Shannon. I'm the Executive Director of Poverty Matters in Los Angeles, and we work on case management, and we use that case management to actually inform legislation that we advocate for here in Sacramento. I'm very proud to actually bring up State Senator Ben Allen, who is here today. He is one of the co-sponsors of legislation that we're putting through, which is SB 1380, and he wanted to stop by, so we wanted to give him a chance to say a few words about how Housing First and homelessness. He's from Senate District 26. He's actually my state senator, which I'm very proud of. And we're going to give him an opportunity to address you today. Thanks.
Well, thank you so much, Susie. Susie Shannon is an extraordinary person. For those of you who haven't worked closely with her, she has been such a wonderful progressive leader on poverty issues, on health issues, on a variety of different things, and really does keep legislators' feet to the fire and keeps bringing up really important progressive policy solutions in the homeless space, and does it in a way that's data-based and evidence-based and with just great grace and dignity, but also determination. And I'm really appreciative of her leadership in the Democratic Party on poverty issues. She really does a tremendous service to our region. By the way, I should mention that the last time I was in this room, it was the ethics training for the state Senate. So I don't know if that's a good thing or a bad thing. I will say we haven't had any problems since then. So maybe we should have been here before. So maybe that's a good sign that we're all here in this room. It's a beautiful room and obviously part of this great court and library complex. So Susie she actually chaired a convening that we had similar to this in some respects down in Hollywood about a year ago, and brought some of the leaders from Utah that had been looking at the Housing First model. And of course Utah, which is not known for its profligacy, shall we say, in terms of social spending, actually did some analysis of their homeless challenges, and they found that it costs quite a bit more to have a homeless person on the street than it did to have them in supportive housing. That's because once you start to add up everything from the cost of sanitation, law enforcement, mental health services, I mean, the list goes on. And they actually saw that they were losing money with the current model that they had of just letting people be out in the streets. And ultimately, they decided to move aggressively toward a housing first model. And they were able to put in place a statewide task force that was headed up by the lieutenant governor, and that brought in all these different stakeholders from the faith-based community right the way over to social service organizations and legislators, and got a lot of buy-in from across the political spectrum. And it was a pretty amazing achievement. And they've effectively ended their homeless population. They're kind of close along the way toward doing that. Now, of course, Utah is a very different state, much lower costs, much smaller homeless population. But we're certainly trying to learn as much as we can from around the country. And Utah has been a kind of a constant and interesting example. The bill that was mentioned that Senator Mitchell has taken the lead on is basically trying to recreate this task force in a certain way, and really putting housing first at the heart of the state's policy. We, of course, also have the No Place Like Home initiative that was launched by the pro tem, the Senate president, with support from across the aisle, that seeks to repurpose Proposition 63 dollars, mental health funds, to help leverage funding for housing first, particularly for folks who've got mental health challenges. And the hope is that $2 billion could actually go up to as much as $10 billion with local, federal, philanthropic, private sector matches coming in from various directions, and really help to push us toward this housing first model. I mean, I think we're going to be talking about this all day today, but the evidence just becomes so abundantly clear that the old model has not been working, that it's been based on bizarre ideas of punishment and retribution and deserving, desert. Not the sweet kind, that are just not based in our experiences on the ground, and that ultimately end up being self-defeating and more costly, and that end up leaving many more people behind. I serve on the Transportation and Housing Committee in the State Senate. I also represent the west side of Los Angeles and the coastal South Bay, which is a generally pretty prosperous area, but we've got an enormous homeless challenge in Hollywood and Venice and Santa Monica and elsewhere. And these are challenges that we're now seeing all over the state as the impact of the recession is really, and also the housing crisis, and has really become felt. We've got so many more people on the streets, and we're all struggling with to find positive solutions to help people live productive lives and get them the support that they need. And so I'm just really appreciative of Susie, Shannon, and Poverty Matters and all the work they're doing. We're working as partners. She was on the floor of the Senate just a couple weeks ago as that bill passed the Senate. And we're now going to really hope to push it to get support from the governor, well, obviously the Assembly, but then eventually the governor. That might be a challenge. He's a very mercurial guy. He's a very smart guy, and in many ways he's been an excellent governor, but he doesn't like being told what to do, and he's got his kind of ideas about the way things ought to be. And we're really hoping that we have to work together to kind of make the case to him that this is the right thing to do, because he's just quirky. He's quirky. So I stand with you. I'm really excited. I'm going to actually have a staffer who I'm literally flying to LA in just a little bit, but I'm going to have a staffer who'll be here monitoring, and we're going to be watching the proceedings, and we're really interested in working with you. There, I will say, having grown up in Los Angeles and having followed state policy and politics for a long, long time, since I was a little kid, I do get the sense that there is a kind of a growing sense of imperative that is at all levels of government. You now actually see the mayor, the mayor of Los Angeles, Eric Garcetti, who's by nature another kind of, he's a cautious guy. I mean, he's sometimes nervous about making bold pronouncements, and he's actually declared a state of emergency and laid out very ambitious goals. And they've actually announced this chunk of money, the $100 million, and then some additional funds that they're going to try to bring in. And they actually are starting to draw a path to that money, which was the original critique that, where's the money going to come from? Well, now they're actually pulling together a plan. The county of Los Angeles is doing something similar. They've got a proposal that's floating around right now for a possible measure on the ballot to address homeless challenges. So, and now, of course, you've got the No Place Like Home initiative. You've got the work that, with SB 1380 that Holly and I are doing. So there does seem to be a sense that you're starting to see the wheels turning from local and state government in philanthropy and the nonprofit sector and elsewhere. So I'm very hopeful that you know let's take advantage of this crisis, right? Let's not let this opportunity pass, and let's try to get a handle on this challenge that ends up wasting so many wonderful lives that are not living up to their full potential, and because we haven't provided the sort of infrastructure and safety net for them to get back on their feet. We know that there are solutions out there. There are incredible nonprofits in my district and elsewhere throughout the state that are doing amazing things, turning around lives every single day. And we just need to get them the resources. We need to get them the help. We need to support them. And that's going to be all of our work together, pushing our elected officials, pushing the state, pushing the local government to get the resources and the laws and support structure in place to finally get a grip on this issue that has really perplexed us for such a long period of time. So let me point out Josh Cohen, who's in the back. He's here from my staff, and he'll be here for some time, taking in the proceedings. And he's a fantastic Senate fellow who's been working with us for the past year and on housing issues and other issues as well. And I just appreciate your time and attention and interest, and we'll be in touch as this process moves forward. So thank you so much. Really appreciate it.
Sorry, I didn't get to finish my point, but I wanted to make sure that the Honorable Senator had a chance to speak before he has to catch his flight. Okay, great. You'll get to hear the rest of my point. So, I was just talking about how we find homeless people in public libraries and why that is. And there's, as I said, an obvious, simple, flat-footed explanation, which is that the public library is one of the last places left in the typical American city that's open to everyone. That has seating and bathrooms that are open to everyone, that's climate controlled in the daytime, and basically a place that you have to misbehave to get kicked out of the library. You can't just be kicked out because they don't like the look of you. So that's nice. It's nice that libraries are here for that. The American Library Association has actually put out an extensive set of guidelines for how to integrate homeless patrons in library services. And actually, for all my library colleagues who are here today, if you haven't read that, I recommend it not just as a way to think about how to serve your homeless patrons better, but to think about homelessness, because in the manner of librarians, it's a very exhaustive and well-researched piece. Actually one of the better primers on homelessness that you'll find out there. But I just think that there's something else to it. I've watched a lot of homeless people using libraries. And it calls into question, really, what does a homeless person not have? We know they don't have something called a home. But is a home just a place to be? Is it just a place where you can go? Historically and intuitively and instinctively, we know that's not true. We know that it isn't just a place that keeps the weather out. It's a place that connects you to other people. That's what a home is, as opposed to a house. And when I see homeless people using libraries, what are they doing? Sometimes, maybe they're just taking a load off, enjoying the AC, using the bathroom. But they're usually doing a lot more than that. They're using email on the computers in the library, connecting maybe with friends or family who are far away. They're sorting out their ID issues with the DMV or the Social Security Administration. They're checking how to get to their appointments with a caseworker, probation officer, psychologist, somebody who's going to help them. They're looking for jobs. They're looking for apartments. They're researching and writing articles for street newspapers. Even an act of connectivity as simple as reading the newspaper for somebody who's been lost and disconnected from society, that can lead to a conversation, that can lead to a friendship, that can lead to an opportunity. I've seen it happen. So there are really two sides to this idea of home. It's a place to be, but it's also a place to connect, a place to be connected to other people. And we need to consider both sides when we talk about homelessness policy. Walls and roofs on their own don't make a home, but neither does connection and community. You also need a place to go. So there's two sides to this puzzle. And I think adding even more complexity to the issue is the fact that these concepts are always in flux. In his excellent new book, The Rise and Fall of American Growth, Robert J. Gordon, an economist, talks about the rise of what he calls the networked home in the first part of the 20th century. And the story he tells is that over the span of just a few decades, from about 1900 to 1940, the typical American house went from being essentially a durable tent, a thing that sat on the ground, kept most of the weather and some of the larger wildlife out, to a node in a matrix of networks, water lines, telephone lines, sewer lines, power lines. And those networks, in Gordon's opinion, and he makes a really strong case, those networks were responsible for much, if not most, of the gains in productivity and quality of life that we associate with the modern era. So these things are in flux. What was considered a home in 1870 would not be considered a home today. You could go into a middle-class home from 1870. I often think about this. If officials from 2016 entered a typical American home from 1870, they would immediately declare it as a substandard dwelling and remove all the people from the home, making them homeless. I can also imagine the occupants of that home coming up to 2016 and visiting those officials, those government officials in their houses, and determining that we're homeless due to our lack or relative lack of kinship networks, connection to neighbors, and participation in local commercial, civic, and religious institutions. So everything's in flux. Home has never stayed the same thing for a century or more. Now, these days we read articles every week about a new generation of young people that aren't leaving home. They aren't leaving their parents' houses. They aren't buying homes. They seem to be willing to share housing well past those college years when roommates used to be normal. And they prefer dense cities to sprawling suburbs. And this seems to be, in every case, a shrinkage in our standard of what a place to be is. It doesn't have to be a room of your own. It doesn't have to be a big backyard. It just is starting to literally just be a place to be. We read articles about people in San Francisco paying hundreds of dollars a month to live in a box in someone's living room or in a tent on someone's deck. That's a low standard of personal space, lower than it used to be. However, the other thing we hear about the young people today is what can't they be without ever? Smartphone. That connection, the place to connect, the place that libraries are in their basic use, is now it's spread across the entire world. The whole surface of the earth is your place to connect, and you never want to be without that. So it's going to change. Things are changing. Maybe in 2070, a house without broadband will be considered substandard. But maybe we'll see more people sleeping on shelves, triple bunking, different solutions, tiny houses. We're going to hear something about that from Steve later on. It's going to be different. That's the one thing we can see when we look at history is it's going to be different in the future. And what all this means for the future of homelessness and the broader question of housing in California, all I can really say is that I'm awed by a lack of an answer, that the horizon of tomorrow is something that I can't draw a picture of for you today. But it's certainly something to stop and think about as we work to solve what I think many of us perceive as a crisis. And, you know, whether you're homeless or housed, the public library is still one of the best places in town to stop and think. And if you're looking for answers, well, a librarian will always be happy to help you. So, thank you. And I'd like to introduce Susie Shannon, who you probably doesn't need an introduction at this point after we heard from Senator Allen. Thank you.
So much pressure now, so much pressure. So as Senator Allen mentioned, I have to get used to saying Senator Allen because Ben and I are actually friends too. So as Senator Allen mentioned, last year we hosted the folks from Utah who came down to sort of explain how they brought Utah into a housing first model. And they are the first state now in the country to have ended chronic homelessness. And they haven't really ended it. They've reached what we call a functional zero. And that means that everyone who could be housed or was willing to be housed, they had space for and provided some type of housing for them. And so their journey, I think, is quite interesting, and how they sort of put this model together is fairly interesting as well. So I just want to talk a little bit about that and then sort of the next iteration of Housing First that we're seeing now. So one of the things that Lloyd did was he met a man named Samson Barris who ran a lot of the pilot programs in New York based on Housing First. And Sam had explained to Lloyd that they had saved, in the context of these pilot programs, they had saved a lot of money by putting people who are homeless into Housing First, which basically means that they don't have to go through sobriety tests and shelters and then transitional housing and a lot of the models that we see, still in place today in many parts of the country. And so Utah, being a very red state and fiscally conservative, really sort of adopted this model based on the fiscal savings. So what they did was they first embarked on a pilot study. And they had 17 people that they housed. And they partially did this because they wanted to engage a lot of the case managers because they were getting a lot of resistance in terms of changing the paradigm and bringing people into Housing First model. So they sort of had to sell it to the case managers and to a lot of the nonprofits who were providing a lot of the services on the ground. And so while they were doing this pilot study with these 17 people who were homeless to move them into housing, they were also at the same time building 100 units to move things forward, which I thought was quite an interesting way to do it. So they knew they wanted to do it, but they also knew that they had to sell people on it. What they also did was they created a housing trust fund, and they created a tax checkoff. Now, a lot of people, when they do their taxes, see these little tax checkoffs, for the fire fund or whatever. They created that in Utah, and it wasn't a lot of money that came into it, and a lot of it they used for services and that are part of the permanent supportive housing. But what it did was it also engaged the electorate in this so that people could say, yes, we want Housing First. Yes, we want to help fund this trust fund. And so that was sort of another element of it, which was sort of the sort of public sort of taxpayer element of their plan. And then something that Ben talked about was they created a coordinating committee. And this coordinating committee, which was a statewide committee, didn't just have department heads talking to each other or department heads with nonprofits. It also included a lot of political muscle. And so they thought they had to sell this to the governor, right? But they thought in order to keep this program going and in order to keep it funded, what we want to do is to engage elected officials. And so they brought in their lieutenant governor to head up the commission, which was really quite brilliant because their lieutenant governor typically becomes their governor. And so they had a new governor, as the new governors would come in, they had the new governor already engaged in a Housing First model, already knowing exactly, what's going on. Also, lieutenant governors sometimes have a lot of extra time on their hands. So it also gave lieutenant governors something to do and to engage in, which is homelessness, which I thought was really quite brilliant. Now, in SB 1380, I think in the original iteration, we had put the lieutenant governor in there, and for some reason, during the course of sort of rewriting it, that part had been taken out. But I'd love to see that sort of as the model here in California as well, although we're a little bit different. So one of the things that they did as well was, so after they had the Housing Trust Fund together, so they had a lot of the funding, they knew they wanted to be on this model. But what they also knew is that there would still be resistance from a lot of the nonprofits who were servicing the actual homeless community and responsible for putting them into housing. So as Lloyd puts it, nonprofits would come to the state, because he was sort of the coordinator for all of this money, and say, okay, now give us money and we'll do Housing First. And he said, well, no, I'm not going to do that, because what's going to happen is I'm going to give you money and then you're just going to go and take that money and do what you're doing, and you're not going to change your model. So what he did was he sort of forced the service providers to do a pilot project first and get them to prove that they had sort of done this, very small pilot project that he funded or that the trust fund funded. And in the context of that, he was able to see, okay, they've sort of changed their model and we're changing the paradigm this way. And I thought that was really brilliant, because I can see just even in Los Angeles, which is a fairly large city. A lot of times this is what we do, is that we say that we want housing first, and we sort of, you know, give money through grants to these, to a lot of nonprofits, but then they sort of stick with the old model, and there's really no oversight, and there's really no regulations. And then what happens is that everyone's still sort of on the old model, but pretending they're not. And so I think in Utah, it was quite brilliant what Lloyd did, in terms of you know, forcing them to change the model first, change the paradigm. And he said in a few, you know, a few organizations and a few of the service providers, the larger ones, didn't come on board, and that was fine too. You know, they did sort of the carrot as opposed to the stick and said, look, you know, we've got money for this. You can come on board, and if you don't want to, that's fine too, and you can sort of stick with the old model. But what's wonderful, what they saw actually was... it was just a tremendous success. So their retention rate for housing was at 80% for the people that they had housed. And they had started with, I think, 1,938 people who were considered chronically homeless and ended up with 178. So what's really important, though, about Utah, because they're the first state to have reached a functional zero in terms of chronic homelessness, is that now we have these statistics. So when an elected official comes to me and says, well, you know, we hear that people don't really want housing. They don't want to, I mean, how many times have we heard that they don't really want to go into housing and they just want to be on the street? And you could say, well, you know, the state of Utah has ended chronic homelessness. And as it turns out, only 9.2% of the people there didn't go in, or this program didn't work for them. But for the most part, right, for 91% or 92%, and in some cases it's 94%, and I'm sure you'll hear a lot of these statistics later, for the most part, people are coming in and they are getting housing. And in Utah, so in many places, you know, it's different in terms of what the cost savings are, but in Utah they saved $8,000 to $10,000 per person that they housed who were chronically homeless, which for them was a tremendous fiscal success as well. And they've, you know, we also, when we brought out sort of the architects of this program last year, we also brought out a recipient. And it just is very life-changing. I mean, I work with people who are homeless, and the protracted period of uncertainty for people who go through the shelter system and then go into transitional housing, and there's always this sense of never knowing where they're going to land, whether or not their case manager is going to, you know, earmark them for a voucher or for something else. It's quite a trying experience emotionally for a lot of our clients. And so I find that this actually is probably the most humanitarian way, as well as obviously the most, the one that makes most sense fiscally, you know, in terms of a model. And I will say too that sort of the next iteration of this that we're seeing in Los Angeles is basically being employed by the county of Los Angeles, which has something called the Housing for Health program. And the way that that program works, because a lot of these programs still rely on housing authorities, and you have to get a voucher, and then sometimes people who are currently homeless with the voucher can't find a landlord who will take them. So that's like another sort of step in this model. But what the county is doing actually is they have something called the flexible subsidized housing pool. And this pool is completely outside of HUD. And they have funded it, I think, with about $10 to $20 million. And what they've done is they brought out an organization called Brilliant Corners from San Francisco. And that organization or company just puts people into housing. So they find units, and they master lease the unit. So basically, the contract is between the county of Los Angeles, the Housing for Health, or Brilliant Corners, actually, and the landlord, as opposed to a tenant landlord, you know, the homeless person being the tenant landlord situation. So what the county does is they have insurance, they guarantee to the landlord that the apartment will be returned in the same, you know, or with reasonable wear and tear condition that they got it in, and then they can put people directly into housing. So that takes out this element where someone has to go around and try to find housing with a voucher. So I see that sort of as the next iteration here of Housing First. 90% of my clients now are actually being housed through this Housing for Health program. And everyone has an underlying chronic illness, have been homeless for at least a year, or I think for the county, everyone has a different definition, but for the county, I think it's 3 times in 5 years that they've been homeless in order to qualify. And it's very easy, it's like a 3-page application. So I'm hoping we're moving into that new model, which I find to be much easier for our clients. To not have to go running around looking for housing with the voucher. But thank you so much for allowing me to speak to you today. And I just want to thank Jason, who put this all together today and invited me to speak. Thank you.
Our next speaker is Tom Byrne from Boston University.
Well, thank you to Jason and to the California Research Bureau for the invitation to be here with you guys today. Really happy to be here and to be part of this discussion, and looking forward to conversation and hearing from some of you guys later today, and hope that I can offer some comments that will enrich the discussion here. So before really diving into things, I just wanted to kind of point to the title of my talk, which I've called Turning Evidence into Action. And I've titled my talk that because I think it's an accurate reflection of the direction in which homeless assistance policy has been going over the past 10 to 15 years nationally, particularly as it pertains to Housing First. And so I'll try and emphasize some of that evidence in my remarks here, and also talk about where I think the evidence is pointing us moving forward. So just to kind of give you a quick overview of what I'm going to talk about, first I'll tell you a little bit about my background and how I came to be doing homelessness and housing-related research. Then kind of want to pivot to that to talk specifically about Housing First and why it is a good policy response to homelessness, and then pivot from there to kind of offer my thoughts on why I think Housing First is a good policy response to homelessness and certainly a piece of a comprehensive policy response to homelessness is not and ought not be seen as the only piece of a policy response to homelessness. So I want to tell you a little bit about why I think Housing First is incomplete as a response to homelessness, and then conclude by offering some thoughts on what I think we need to do more of in order to have a fully comprehensive response to the problem of homelessness. So just a little bit about me. What you're looking at here is a picture of the Pine Street Inn, which is a homeless service organization in Boston. It's the largest provider of homeless services in New England. And I've put it up here for a few reasons. First, it's located in Boston, which is the city where I grew up and where I first encountered the issue of homelessness as a kid, going downtown with my family for church and various things and seeing folks living on the streets. Second, this is an organization at which I spent a significant amount of time when I was in college volunteering, and it was where I kind of got my first on-the-ground experience and understanding of the issue of homelessness from talking with some of the guests at Pine Street Inn. Later went on to do some street outreach work in Paris, France, when I was lucky enough to be studying there and kind of got a different perspective on the issue. From there, spent some time working as a case manager in a permanent supportive housing program for homeless families, and at some point along the way came across some research done by a professor at the University of Pennsylvania named Dennis Culhane, who's done a lot of work in this area, and ended up having the privilege to work with him as a graduate student, where I got involved with this issue from a research perspective, which is kind of how I've ended up where I am today. And the last thing I want to mention about Pine Street Inn is that this is an organization that over the past couple of years has drastically restructured its approach to homelessness from a focus on primarily emergency shelter to one that has really embraced Housing First and housing-focused solutions to homelessness. So before diving into some of the evidence base on housing first, I thought I'd take a minute just to provide a quick overview of what housing first actually is, kind of focusing on some of the core principles of housing first and the concepts that underlie the model. So as its name implies, housing first, the bedrock principle of it is to provide rapid access to permanent housing with no preconditions, meaning that folks are not required to be in compliance with substance abuse, mental health, or any other type of treatment prior to entering housing. It is housing first, as its name implies, with no preconditions whatsoever. However, it's not housing only. Folks in housing first are provided with individualized supports that are voluntary but are geared towards helping people maintain housing stability and also achieve more positive outcomes in other areas of their lives. And a core component or kind of underpinning housing first is the idea that actually being in stable housing and having the stability that it provides is actually essential for making progress in some of these other areas towards mental health and substance abuse recovery in particular. And a key element of housing first is this idea of consumer choice. And in fact, housing first was generated sort of from the ground up by folks going out and actually talking to people who were experiencing homelessness and asking them what they wanted. And sure enough, surprise, surprise, what people wanted was a permanent house, a place to live, right? So this is a model that not only places consumer choice at the center, but was developed in response to consumer needs. So with its emphasis on immediate placement in permanent housing, Housing First stands in stark contrast to what had been the prevailing model of access to permanent housing, which is referred to either as the linear continuum model or the staircase model, which placed treatment compliance sort of at the forefront and made folks go through a series of steps before they could be deemed housing ready and were provided access to permanent housing. And of course, Housing First kind of flips that model on its head and says we don't need those intermediary steps. People don't need to access treatment. What we need to do is get them into housing, and once they're housed, provide them with services that are going to help them achieve more positive outcomes in other areas of their lives. So it's kind of an inversion of what had been traditionally the model. So something that's important to emphasize here is kind of about the target population for Housing First. The original target population was people with serious mental illness who are experiencing homelessness. It's since been expanded and applied more generally to folks who are chronically homeless, usually with a disabling condition. So it's been tested in research studies with folks who have a chronic medical condition or who have severe alcohol disorders. But the key point here is that Housing First is really intended to serve the most chronically homeless folks, the hardest to serve population. And that's sort of a key point to keep in mind and something that I'll come back to when I talk a little bit more about why this is not necessarily a one-size-fits-all solution to homelessness. All right, so why is Housing First a good policy? I would argue that there's two main reasons why Housing First is a sound policy response to homelessness. The first is that I would say that it responds to a moral imperative and a moral obligation that we as society have to assist folks who are highly vulnerable and who are living on the streets. So that's reason number one. The second reason that it's sound public policy, and one that actually I think has been more of a driving force as to why it has been adopted throughout the country, is that it has a really sound evidence base as an intervention that works and as one that makes efficient use of public resources in the process and can, in some cases, lead to cost savings. So I'll spend a few minutes just kind of going quickly through some of the key points of evidence from research that's been conducted on Housing First, just to kind of drive home that second point. So in talking about the evidence on housing first, kind of the first natural starting point is looking at its impact on housing stability. So what you see here is a slide that summarizes the results of from one of the earliest studies on housing first that was conducted in New York cities. It was the Pathways to Housing model that Susie talked about, which was pioneered by Sam Simbaris. And what they did is essentially, in the same way that we test new medicines to see whether they're effective, they use sort of the same research design to do this, which is randomly assign some folks to get housing first and some folks to receive treatment as usual, which in this case was sort of that staircase model of housing. And then they followed them over a period of years. And lo and behold, what they found is that after 5 years, about nearly 90% of the folks who had been placed in housing first were still in that housing, whereas less than half of folks who had been in that linear or staircase model were in stable housing. And it's interesting, so this is just one study. This is a study, there's been a number of studies that have used similar designs and have been conducted in other places, and they have remarkably consistent results, which is retention rates in housing of 80 to 90% for folks in housing first. So I won't show findings from some of these other studies, but when looking at specific subgroups of folks experiencing homelessness, there's been similar findings from research studies testing housing first for veterans experiencing homelessness, same results, high retention rates. When looking at folks with severe alcohol problems or chronic illnesses, same results, really high retention rates. And an important thing here is that as part of these studies, what they do is they ask people if they feel as though they have greater consumer choice and satisfaction with their housing after they're placed in housing first, and people like it. So not only does it actually have a strong impact on housing stability, it actually improves people's satisfaction and quality of life as well. Now the other, while the impact on housing stability is really important, the other key piece of evidence from research on housing first is around the impact of housing stability on the utilization and cost of public services. So as Susie alluded to, the target population for housing first, folks who are chronically homeless, are usually very heavy utilizers of public services. So they're cycling between emergency departments, emergency shelters, inpatient hospitalization, and so forth, and that can be cumulatively very expensive. Studies have shown folks use $40,000, $50,000, $100,000 in public services over the course of a year. But what a number of studies have shown is that once placed in permanent housing, their utilization of these public services declines dramatically once folks are stably housed. And so this is, there's been a number of studies that have looked at this. Since we're here in California, I thought I'd show you one from a study that was conducted a few years ago of Los Angeles's Project 50, where they tried to identify 50 of the most vulnerable folks on Skid Row and put them in housing. And what they found was, as you can see, dramatic reductions in the utilization of substance abuse services, jail, medical, and mental health services. So total cost reductions totaled almost $25,000, and that was enough to outstrip the cost of the intervention itself, such that over a two-year period, the net savings were about $4,800 per unit. One thing that I want to note here is that this is a study that looked at, and typically these cost studies are looking at the most vulnerable high-cost users who have a lot of cost to offset, right? So it's true that housing first is associated with reductions in costs, but it's not always the case that it's going to result in cost savings for everyone who's placed in housing first. That being said, it could be the case that the folks who are the heaviest users, who generate net cost savings, some of those cost savings could be helpful in subsidizing or offsetting some of the costs that is associated with providing housing to some of the less heavy service utilizers. One other thing that I want to mention briefly here is that probably the most rigorous and largest scale study of housing first was recently completed in Canada. It was funded by the Canadian government. It was about $50 million study that was done in 5 or 6 cities throughout Canada. And this study just wrapped up, and their results were remarkably similar to what studies here in the United States have found. Huge impact on housing stability, big improvements in housing stability associated with Housing First, and big reductions in the utilization of public services. And this leads me to kind of another interesting point, which is that when it comes to homelessness and specifically Housing First, this is actually one of the rare instances in social welfare policy where the United States is actually a leader and other countries are kind of following our lead in how to address this problem. So Housing First has been adopted in Europe, in Australia, in Canada, and it's kind of an interesting story where typically where the United States is kind of a laggard in social policy, we're actually a leader when it comes to addressing homelessness. So the last thing that I want to mention is that there are some strong indications that at the aggregate, so the community and nationwide level, that increases in the stock of the availability of Housing First or permanent supportive housing, which is what's shown in this graph, is linked with reductions in chronic homelessness. So this is a chart that I made based on data from the Department of Housing and Urban Development's annual homeless assessment report to Congress. And what this shows is changes in the point in time count of the number of folks who are experiencing chronic homelessness, so the number of people nationwide who are homeless on a given night. Now there's a lot of noise in some of those point in time counts, but I think there's definitely a trend here. So what you see is that blue line is reductions in chronic homelessness since 2007. So the number of folks experiencing chronic homelessness has dropped by about 30% since 2007. And what that gray line shows is the percent change in the number of permanent supportive housing, which is kind of a broader umbrella term for Housing First, over that same time period. So there's definitely, correlation does not imply causation here, but there's definitely a growth in the availability of permanent supportive housing nationwide that has been accompanied by a decrease in chronic homelessness. So I led a study that tried to look at this in a more rigorous fashion to see whether there is a statistically significant relationship between growth in permanent supportive housing at the community level and changes in chronic homelessness over time. And what we found is after you control for other things like rent levels, housing vacancy rates, and a number of other things, you see a significant relationship between permanent supportive housing and chronic homelessness at the community level, such that communities that add relatively more permanent supportive housing over time experience faster decreases in the rate of chronic homelessness. One last thing that I want to mention briefly here is that my colleagues and I have done some research looking at changes in the age distribution of the homeless population since 1990. And what we've identified is a cohort effect in the single adult homeless population. So what you're seeing there, the red line is the age distribution of the homeless single adult homeless population in 1990, when the peak age was around 30 to 32. The green line is age distribution in 2000, when the peak age was around 40 or 42. And the blue line is the age distribution in 2010, where the peak age was 49 to 52. So this is a population where folks born roughly between 1955 and 1964 have been overrepresented in the single adult homeless population for the past 20 years. And this is relevant to housing first because these are people that are now approaching their early 60s and their life expectancy, and absent an increase in the availability of permanent housing under a housing first model for this population, the alternative is likely to be nursing homes funded by Medicaid, which is quite expensive. So this is kind of a last little plug for the importance of housing first for the population of folks experiencing chronic homelessness. So just to sum up housing first, why is it good policy? First, it's effective. It works at improving housing stability. People like it. It aligns with what consumers want. Third, it can generate cost offsets, and in some cases can be cost neutral or even lead to cost savings. And finally, there's some strong indications that in the aggregate at the community level, it drives decreases in the rate of chronic homelessness. That said, housing first is not a complete and comprehensive solution to homelessness. What this graph is showing is findings from a landmark study that was conducted by my colleague Dennis Culhane in the late 1990s that looked at the dynamics of homelessness over time. And what he found is that what you're seeing here, this is data from New York City, the gray bars are percentage of shelter users, and the blue bars are percentage of shelter days used. And essentially what he found is that about 10% of the population of folks experiencing homelessness are chronically homeless, meaning that they have extended episodes of homelessness, but they use about 50% of shelter resources. And this helped generate some of the policy focus on folks experiencing chronic homelessness because they were making disproportionate use of shelter resources, and they became the target population for housing first. And while this is definitely a worthy population to assist, we know from this study and from other data points that they're only a minority of the overall homeless population. There's a lot more people who experience homelessness on a more transitional or temporary basis, and there's just not a lot of resources that are available for those folks besides emergency shelter in most communities. So just to give you a sense of this, doing some back-of-the-envelope math with data from HUD's annual homeless assessment report to Congress, what I came up with is about 900,000 people, or about two-thirds of the overall homeless population over the course of a year is comprised of single adults who are experiencing non-chronic or what we might call crisis homelessness. And again, for these folks, there's really not much for them except emergency shelter in most communities. So we're calling these folks crisis homelessness because for the majority of these people, their homelessness is triggered by some sort of event that leads to a housing crisis. So here again, this is data from HUD's annual homeless assessment report to Congress. And what you see is among folks who enter shelter in a given year, less than half are actually already homeless at their time of entry into shelter. And the majority of them are coming either from housing with family and friends, their own housing situation, or from having been recently released from an institutional setting. So what you have is kind of something, an eviction, conflict with a family member, or discharge from an institutional setting, an event that's triggering a housing crisis for these people that's leading to their homelessness. And what's important to note here is that our gains in addressing chronic homelessness have far outstripped our progress in addressing chronic homelessness. So when you take out the gains made in chronic homelessness from the number of folks, single adults who are homeless at any given night, what you see is that we really haven't experienced much of a change in what I would call crisis homelessness over the past 8 or 9 years, whereas we've made really good, great strides against chronic homelessness. And again, a lot of this is due to the fact that for most people in most communities, the only resource that's available to them is emergency shelter, which really isn't effective, while it serves an important need, isn't effective at helping people exit homelessness. So what's encouraging in thinking about where we need to go in terms of doing a better job of addressing not only chronic but crisis homelessness is that there's been some really positive trends in recent years. We've seen kind of the emergence of a new conceptual model focused primarily on housing stabilization. And so this is something that aligns much better with the observed dynamics of homelessness as a phenomenon that for most people is fairly brief and non-recurrent. So the focus on housing stabilization kind of reflects a new and more narrowly focused mission for the homeless assistance system. You can think about the homeless assistance system under this model as being akin to the emergency department in the healthcare delivery system, wherein people come to the emergency department because they're having a crisis. The emergency department stabilizes them and gets them linked with more appropriate long-term services. In the same regard, this focus on housing stabilization is meant to help people deal with an immediate housing crisis, help them stabilize in permanent housing. It's not intended to address every problem that a person might have. It's not intended to be an anti-poverty system. It's just a narrow focus on helping people quickly regain housing stability. So in practice, the emergence of this model has been accompanied by the implementation of programs on the ground that actually put this into action. So in the wake of the Great Recession, there was a $2 billion program called the Homelessness Prevention and Rapid Rehousing Program, which lasted for 3 years and provided communities with funds to be used to either help prevent homelessness among people who were at risk or to help get people who were newly homeless back into housing as quickly as possible with short-term but highly flexible forms of assistance. Some of this was codified into federal homeless assistance programs with the reauthorization of the big federal homeless assistance programs. And more recently, the Department of Veterans Affairs has created its own prevention and rapid rehousing program called Supportive Services for Veteran Families, which is a nationwide program that provides grants to nonprofit agencies to help veteran households who are at risk of homelessness or who are currently experiencing homelessness to get back into housing as quickly as possible. And so real quick, this is evidence from a study that I led that looked at the outcomes of veterans who were assisted under this new model of rapid rehousing. So it's short-term, highly flexible assistance that helps people get into housing by paying security deposits, short-term rental assistance, things of that nature. And what we found is that about 1 year, about 10% of folks who were at risk of homelessness and got prevention assistance actually returned to the VA homeless programs, and about 15% of folks who received rapid rehousing returned to homelessness. The numbers were a little bit higher at 2 years, but still pretty high housing stability and housing retention rates in this program at 2 years. So this experience with the SSVF program points to the potential of rapid rehousing and some of these models focused on housing stabilization as promising solutions to crisis homelessness. The issue is that the resources are just not adequate for folks who are not veterans at this point. And so what we need is some creative new solutions to find resources to help fund some of these programs too, help folks experiencing crisis homelessness. So one idea that we are proposing, and we are working on a white paper that will flesh this out in more detail, is to adapt an intervention known as critical time intervention, which is from the behavioral health field, which was originally piloted with folks with mental illness exiting shelter in New York City. And it provides short-term assistance to help get people into a stable situation in the community and link them with community resources that will help them maintain housing stability. And this has a strong evidence base. It's been proven to be effective. It has been proven to be associated with lower costs. And what's important here is that there's been some recent guidance from Medicaid to suggest that the services that are part of this critical time intervention could be reimbursable by Medicaid, which would provide a big new pool of resources to help address crisis homelessness, especially in states that have expanded Medicaid, where now folks, the majority of the single adult homeless population is newly eligible for Medicaid. So I won't go through this in too much detail, just kind of in the interest of time and wanting to hear from the other speakers and from you all, but just wanted to conclude with a few thoughts. First, Housing First is a crucial and highly effective component of efforts to address homelessness. However, we need a comprehensive and scalable, we need an analog response for crisis homelessness. And I also want to acknowledge that we also need to go further upstream with what I would say are primary prevention efforts, things like expanding the availability of affordable housing as part of a comprehensive solution to homelessness. But it's not a zero-sum game. I think these two things often get put in opposition to one another, which is to say that some folks will argue that we really can't do anything about homelessness because it's really a problem of affordable housing and we should put all of our efforts there. And I don't think that it's a zero-sum game. I think that we can have a homeless assistance system that does a better job of responding to housing crisis while at the same time pursuing upstream interventions to address affordable housing. So with that, I'll close, and I think we're gonna have questions at the end, and I look forward to a discussion with all of you in a few minutes. Thanks.
Our next speaker is a really wonderful asset here at the State Library at the California Research Bureau. We're so lucky to have her, Shahara Hyatt. She's the director of the California Homeless Youth Project. You're not paying for her. She goes out and gets her own money, but we house her at the library and give her in-kind support for all of her wonderful activities. So please welcome Shahara, who's going to talk to us about youth homelessness.
Yeah, the state's not paying for me, but they should be because it's super important work I do. So, yeah, thank you all so much for being here this afternoon. I'm super happy to be with you and talk with you about an issue that is so near and dear to my heart, and I'm sure most of yours. And I'm really curious, how many of you in your work with people experiencing homelessness or work on the policy level around homelessness or housing issues, just by show of hands? Most of you, okay. So yeah, it's a fairly knowledgeable group. Great. I'll try to tailor it accordingly. So as Jason said, you know, I'm the director of the California Homeless Youth Project, and we're in the California Research Bureau, and our goal is to educate policymakers on the needs of homeless youth throughout the state of California. So basically, I get to read and write and talk about youth homelessness to anybody who will listen, and I'm happy that you all are that group today. And so we write publications really on all matter of issues impacting young people experiencing homelessness in our state. It looks like they've mostly gotten snapped up, but I did bring a sampling of them here for you. There's a couple left. All of them are available on our website too. But so today I wanted to, you know, share a little bit about host homes, and I'll explain what that model is. I'm going to talk about a personal story, and then some of the evidence out there about it working, sort of the research and who's doing this model, and then just pose some questions for thought or discussion for us when that comes around. So I think maybe I will start by, you know, talking a little about youth homelessness in the state of California. You're all probably fairly familiar with how we identify, like, how many people are experiencing homelessness. The metrics that we use are not great, both like the point in time count, which is HUD's count, that takes place every other year, and that kind of identifies people who are living outside or in abandoned buildings, cars, things like that. Or also there's like a homeless inventory count of how many people are in like shelters or transitional housing or supportive housing. So that's one of the ways that we know. That count tends to really undercount, under-identify youth and families experiencing homelessness. It really does target like a chronically homeless adult population. And so we don't really get great numbers from the point in time count about youth homelessness. But one of the things we do know from that count is that California has the second highest rate of unsheltered homeless youth in the country. So it's about 80% of the homeless youth that we've identified across our state have been identified as unsheltered. And why is that the case? Well, two-thirds of California's 58 counties have no program specifically for homeless youth. So there is no shelter, transitional housing, or supportive housing specifically designed to meet the needs of young people who are homeless. And I think that that is kind of an important thing to think about when we talk about, you know, people being service resistant. But we know that in most communities across our state and across the country, there are not enough services to meet that need. And we know in California that's particularly true when it comes to youth. So that was based on some research that we did at the California Research Bureau in 2010. And so that's not, you know, 2016. We don't think that those numbers have changed very much because there hasn't been any significant new state or federal funding for homeless youth programs since that time. So one of the other ways that we count how many people are experiencing homelessness when we're talking about youth is the Department of Education. In schools, we identify young people who are homeless. And so in the 2013-14 school year, California had about 300,000 students experience homelessness at some point during that school year. And that's the largest share of any state in the country. So again, happy that we're here today because this is a crisis not only for our country, but it's particularly true in the state of California. And it's an issue that doesn't really get the bandwidth it deserves for what a significant problem it is. So always happy to see these conversations coming about. And I agree with what Susan was saying, that it does seem like there seems to be particular momentum around homelessness in the Capitol and really taking this seriously and addressing it. And that's really exciting for me as someone who does research and policy and advocacy work. So, okay. So, is anybody in here familiar with host homes as a model? No? Anybody want to take a guess what that is? Yeah. I like to give people the opportunity. Yeah. Yeah, essentially that. I mean, and that's a really elegant way to put it. You know, usually it's a community member, somebody who is volunteering a space in their home. And then ideally it's connected to a service provider who works with people experiencing homelessness so that they can provide, you know, case management, resources and support for the young person who's being placed in a home. And then also support to like the host home provider, whoever they are. So yeah, that's sort of the arrangement. And I'll get into more kind of like the specifics around that, but host homes are a really flexible model, and so there isn't really one specific definition, but that's essentially it. So for me, the seed was planted one night when a good friend of mine came over to my house, and she happens to be a street outreach worker for homeless youth here in Sacramento. And we were sitting around in my living room, and we were talking about just kind of lamenting the lack of services and housing for these young people that we know and love so dearly. And I sort of offhandedly mentioned to her, like, man, you know, sometimes I wonder if I should be doing more with my living room. And, and you know, nobody is more aware, I think, of the lack of services than she. You know, the organization that she worked for, it has a drop-in center, there's an emergency shelter for minors, which has about 6 beds, and then a transitional shelter for young adults, 18 to 24, with about 6 beds. And the waiting list is about 9 months long. So if you've found yourself homeless, you've bounced on your last couch, you don't have another place to stay, then you can potentially be sleeping outside for up to 9 months if you're lucky enough to get one of those very few spots. And if when your number comes up, you're reachable, you're safe, you have a cell phone, things like that. And like I said, when we look at the state of California, it's even bleaker because for two-thirds of our counties, there is no wait list to sign on for that transitional shelter because there isn't one. So this is even, you know, borderline best case scenario where we actually have an option in Sacramento. But that's the only shelter in like a 6-county region. So critical lack of services. I'm gonna set this here. Yeah, and so after, you know, a young person has been living outside for 6 to 9 months, the health, mental health, substance use issues are so much more severe. They're harder to serve, more expensive to serve, not to mention just the impact of the trauma of living outside. Not knowing where you're going to sleep is a traumatic event, which is usually further reinforced by other types of trauma while living outside: physical abuse, sexual abuse, harassment from community members, or others, theft, things like that. One of the things that I say often is that homeless youth are so much more likely to be the victims rather than the perpetrators of crime, but the way we tend to respond to them as a community is as if they are criminals. And there's nothing inherently criminal about not having a home. And I think that, you know, so much of the time we think of it as an individual problem, or a problem that is due to the deficits of individuals rather than the deficits of us, because we realize that we have a national crisis of homelessness because of specific funding and policy decisions that we make. So back to my story. I was going to the drop-in center. I went to WIND, and as I often do, to meet with the young people there. And this time I had brought my camera with me because I wanted to tape their responses to a Department of Justice statement saying that it is cruel and unusual to sleep outside when you have no other options. And this was an issue that that youth had been talking to me about through our youth council work here in Sacramento for quite some time. And so I was like, wow, the federal government said something about this. What do you think? And I got there. Yeah, got their responses, and that's where I met Mo. And he was full of energy and enthusiasm on that issue. He had been sleeping outside. He was staying in Discovery Park or sleeping on the steps of City Hall here in Sacramento. Had to, you know, get up at 5 o'clock in the morning when they would ask him to leave, things like that. And so he had a lot to say on the matter. He had frequently interacted with law enforcement officers. So we talked a lot that day, both about the criminalization of homelessness and then also about just his aspirations to go to college. The semester was starting soon, and he told me that he really wanted to trade the clothes in his backpack for books. And I was like, well, you know, if you ever need any help with anything, let me know. And he was like, yeah, and if you ever need any help with anything, let me know. And we just kind of had an instant connection. And so he didn't know it, but when I went back home, I talked to my partner. I started laying the foundation for this idea of a host home. Told him about the concept, told him about this young guy, Mo, specifically. And at first, he was skeptical. You know, he didn't know this young person, and he didn't know what it meant to have to rely on a community outside of your own family to meet your basic needs, like I had as a young person. And so the conversations sort of continued as I went back to WIND to keep filming. And eventually, I heard the magic words from my partner, which was, I'll support you no matter what. And I was like, yes. So the day that Mo got his GED, I decided to have him over for pizza. It was like, I had been at the drop-in center. I was so proud of him. This was a huge accomplishment in his life. And so I invited him over. And we decided to ask him if he wanted to stay the night. And yeah, he did. He was really, really excited too. But he tried to play it really cool. We eventually talked about how much that moment meant to both of us, but how nonchalant we tried to be about, you know, embarking on a new relationship together. So Mo ended up living with me for about 4 months. And during that time, he was able to build the social capital needed to find employment and find another place to stay. He reconnected with his brother. I live in Midtown here in Sacramento. So he was, you know, he was out and about skateboarding, making friends, and was able to, you know, address, it's like, there are a couple of issues, right? There's the economic poverty that young people are experiencing homelessness are facing, and there's also the relationship poverty. You know, through building that social capital, he was really able to also find other, like, economic avenues and stabilize his health and mental health in ways that allowed him to be successful, you know, when he got a job. Because finding work while you're currently homeless is incredibly difficult. You don't have a place to shower, keep your belongings, you know, things like this, have a permanent address. So that was really beautiful to witness and be a part of. And I learned so much throughout the process of having him stay with me. One, that like building trust took some time. Like I really had to say the same thing over and over again, like take a piece of fruit, take a piece of fruit, take a piece of fruit, before he would feel comfortable to like take a piece of fruit. I'm like, oh great, a banana's gone today. or like, you know, you can leave your stuff here. You can leave your stuff here. And then, you know, eventually I saw he was using the drawer that I had set aside. So there were so many, yeah, successes to celebrate along the way. At a certain point, I started to think about, too, you know, how do I help this go from being like a crash pad to a launch pad? How can I make sure that this, you know, young person who hasn't been stably housed for quite some time, who doesn't have really like independent living skills, because if you're homeless as you're becoming an adult, you may not know how to, you know, cook and clean and grocery shop and things like that. So we started doing those things together. And so, you know, it was sort of like a mentorship relationship, but not a class. I was just living my life, and he was, like, coexisting with me, and we were hanging out as buddies. I wasn't, even though I am a social worker, I wasn't his social worker. I was just, like, a person. And so, yeah, we would have family meetings or, like, house meetings. We switched up at least once a week. We would have a family meal together, decide, like, who was going to be the head chef and who was going to be, like, the sous chef. And that was a lot of fun because he also liked to cook, and so did I, so we bonded a lot over that. And then the biggest challenge, though, was an exit strategy. So knowing that we were still lacking in the community resources to be able to have him find more stable housing, that had not changed. But also that I wasn't prepared for this to be, you know, a forever situation. Even though I wanted our relationship to continue, I still was in a one-bedroom apartment, and it wouldn't be sustainable to have him there always. Yeah, but like so many, I think it's great to recognize the resiliency of people experiencing homelessness, and knowing that, you know, folks are such survivors, and young people who have been forced to grow up sort of quicker than they should, often do have a lot of skills. And I think that so much of the time we're like otherizing people who are homeless and really looking at them from sort of like all of the challenges that folks are facing and not recognizing all of the resiliency they have. Like he was incredibly prideful. He, yeah, would not ask for money or hardly ask for support or rides, even stuff that he really needed. And so he was able to, like I said, you know, develop the relationships with people in order to get a more stable housing situation, job situation. You know, he did enroll in college, did take two classes that first semester, which was an amazing start, and got to, yeah, trade his clothes for books in his backpack. And that was amazing. So, so to think about it a little bit, you know, I thought that maybe contextualizing it in terms of, like, this story kind of helps to tell it more than if I just gave you, like, a textbook definition or talked about, like, program models, because then you can sort of see with me what this looks like. But some of the things that we know about host home programs across the country, they tend to be effective with certain communities. Like some programs tend to serve, like, homeless youth who are in high school to like help them, you know, achieve like success in graduating high school. Some of them target college students in particular. I know that DePaul University has like a 12-week host home program where they sort of connect their college students who are experiencing housing instability or like a crisis with adults in the community who have a spare bedroom and are willing to, you know, play that role. And then they have a case manager that provides support and services so that the host parents, you know, don't have to feel responsible for, you know, meeting the educational or legal or health or whatever needs of this young person. And I think in our state level conversations, we're talking about, you know, college graduation, what it takes for young people to be successful. You know, when we ask focus groups of young people what they would need to be successful, two things really come up. One is that they need a loving, supportive adult. That's one thing I hear over and over again. And again, that speaks to that, you know, lacking the relationships necessary to be successful. The second thing that I hear is that they need their basic needs to be met. So if you're worried about how you're gonna find, yeah, a place to sleep or housing or food, you're not gonna be great at achieving academic success because those things are so fundamental and yeah, ultimately really distracting. And we know that one of the biggest barriers to college graduation is affordability, and not just not just tuition. Sometimes, you know, housing can be a bigger share of the costs of college than tuition itself. And then the other associated costs, transportation, books, supplies, things like that. So I think that's an important thing to consider for our state. This concept also works best when it's a like grassroots model. So because we aren't exactly talking about the foster care system, we wouldn't want to like replicate something that is as bureaucratic for the youth and for the parents as foster care. I think something that is more low barrier that really responds to the independence and self-determination of young people, maybe particularly young adults, is more effective. And then also, one of the biggest challenges to the model is identifying kind of like these homes. Who wants to do this? And with all of the stigma that we have around like homelessness and who we think people experiencing homelessness are, it can be really difficult to convince folks. But what was interesting to me, when I decided to take Mo in, I told myself that I would also simultaneously work to build community capacity to start a host home program in Sacramento. And I started meeting with people that were also doing this, like other host homers that were doing this informally, because we don't actually have a program for it. And what was interesting is that it was doctors and social workers, people that were working specifically with homeless youth or with queer youth, who were meeting these young people, absolutely loving them. And once you know who these folks are, it's so much harder to say, yeah, go back out there, you can sleep outside. And I think that for so many of us, you know, our existence can be sheltered enough to not have to be faced with the personal question of what can I do to help solve a problem that we are all culpable in? And I think it's worth considering earnestly. Yeah, host homes is obviously something that like already happens informally in so many communities, and I think it's worthwhile to think about how can we make sure that there is funding available to scale it up and to make sure that people who are taking this role on have the support necessary to be successful. I wonder if you know any of you have heard of or been part of you know taking a young person in who's you know, maybe parents cannot take care of them, or you've been that young person yourself. I know I have been that young person myself. And if you're able to be attached to a program that serves people experiencing homelessness, then you may be able to stay and not get kicked out because they're able to do like conflict resolution or provide a small stipend, things like that. I know that some programs do provide stipends to host home families that are comparable to what a foster parent may get. In some cases, folks have been able to leverage like federal grants, like from the Administration of Children and Families or Runaway and Homeless Youth grants, to pay host home providers. That's been particularly true in rural communities. Others have found other grants or relied on the faith-based community or their like donation drives to supplement. But I think that it's kind of exciting. This model is sort of exciting for me because it is so cost effective. You know, when we think about other institutionalized settings, they're so much more costly and so much less developmentally appropriate. And so just like for us in the state of California with a foster care system, we're really looking away from congregate care or institutionalized settings because they have not served youth well. And we want to do the same for young people who have maybe been missed by that system or have opted out of that system. Yeah, we know that homeless youth tend to experience the same, you know, abuse, neglect, poverty that a lot of kids in the foster care system do. But the reality is that when that's the case for you and you're 14, 15, 16, 17, a lot of times a child welfare report isn't made. And it can be just really difficult to get into the foster care system, even if you have experienced abuse and if you are technically eligible. So thinking about having a continuum of options and using host homes as an addition to the continuum of options available, I think would be good. Like to me, it's not an alternative to emergency or transitional or supportive housing, rather an addition that we should all consider in light of the lack of housing options that we currently have. Because we know that with 80% of our homeless youth being unsheltered, according to the point in time count, we're clearly you know, we either don't have the right programs or enough programs to meet the needs of these young people. So,
Yeah, I think I'm going to go ahead and end it there, but I have so much more to say on the subject, and so I'd be happy to engage in discussion with any particular questions when we get to that point. So thank you all so much. I'm going to pass it back to Jason.
I'd like to introduce Steve Waters, anthropology instructor at Los Rios Community College District and the executive director of Sacramento's First Step Communities. Thank you.
As you can see from the slide, I want to talk a little bit about something that I've titled Beyond Housing First, Closing the Housing Gap. And I'll try to work my way through explaining what I mean by that. And the way I'd like to do that is to read you some of my prepared comments, but also just give you some feeling for what I went through. How did I get involved in this, and how did this shape the kind of proposal that the nonprofit that I'm working with is putting together and is proposing here in Sacramento as, I don't want to say an alternative to Housing First, because it isn't in any way. What it really is something that we can use to help us along the way to Housing First, if you will. I'll try to explain that. As an ethnographic researcher looking at homelessness, I quickly understood that a number of people living outdoors, on the streets, in vehicles, and as here in Sacramento, in the woods and the brush along the periphery of urban areas, that it began increasing substantially during the post-industrial period of the late 1970s, and that's when I first got involved. During the 1980s, across the U.S., we experienced a continued increase in homeless populations as an economic recession drove unemployment up to around close to 10%. Startlingly, as the economic indicators improved in the later 1980s, the homeless population kept growing. It didn't go back down, and it kept right on growing into the 1990s. Now, when I first became interested in homelessness, I was a rather young undergraduate student in the 1970s here in Sacramento. And I went out on a project and I filmed, doing ethnographic interviews, homeless people living along our rivers. It was a different time. The individuals I filmed in the 1970s reflected really the culture of the times. They reflected the disenfranchised individuals of the 1970s in America. I spoke with self-described fruit tramps, which were individuals that were riding the rails following the harvest up and down the Sacramento and San Joaquin Valleys, and in some cases up to Oregon. I found senior citizens at the time living in the woods along the rivers. One individual I remember very well had a cardboard home with three rooms, and he had his own rowboat out there, and each month he would walk into downtown and pick up his Social Security check. A lot of the people I found at that time were struggling with alcoholism. It was a major problem at the time, still is to some extent. And perhaps what stuck with me the most in those early days filming that in late 1970s was the recently returned Vietnam veterans that I was running into. I mean, there were young men, in this case, hiding in the bushes, living in the bushes, just shaking, and obviously suffering from, with today's knowledge, what we know as PTSD, but back then, which was undiagnosed and untreated. It was some of the most terrifying cases I ever ran into. A lot of the people I ran into in the late 1970s were men. Very few, if any, women during that particular research period that I did, here in Sacramento anyway. Most were white males, ranging in age from their 30s to their 60s, and most were pretty much invisible to the general public. Years later, in 2009, I returned. After a career in other fields, I went back to what I was most interested in. I returned to the homeless camps along the rivers here in Sacramento and started doing research on homelessness. And I found a homeless population with a really different set of demographics than previously. While they reflected the culture changes since the 1970s, there were not only many more men of all ethnicities, but there were also a large number of women of all ages and ethnicities, and their stories reflected the systemic societal factors that contributed to their disenfranchised and homeless existence. I'll just quickly bullet a couple because other people have already very well described this, but of course there were women fleeing domestic violence, fearful not only of living outdoors for the first time in their life, but fearful that a violent ex-partner might find them. There were other people, including women, that were out there because of traumatic life events, death of a child, an ugly divorce, bankruptcy, estrangement from family for a variety of reasons. And youth was represented, too, along the rivers. I found people in this period of 2009 to 2012, when I spent so much time out there, a lot of transitional age youth in the 16 to 24 years of age category. Many were, as we've heard before, foster care graduates, runaways, young men and women who were either estranged from family or were without families at all to return to. And a lot of them, it was more of an episodic type of homelessness they were experiencing. There were many other reasons. There were even college students living out along our rivers here in Sacramento, and women college students, young women. There's one instance that always sticks in my mind. I was in a camp one night, and I was having dinner with some people, and we were talking after dinner. And I saw kind of the glow of a computer screen coming from a tent, kind of at the corner of the camp. And I went over and I looked in and kind of, you know, you kind of knock and announce yourself. And there was a young woman about 22 years of age who was a college student. She was running her computer off a car battery that had been charged during the day. There was no car, just a car battery. And an inverter that the rest of her campmates had created for her, kind of an innovative system of getting some electricity to her PC. So she could work at night. In the morning, she was up early and on her way to classes. And I ran into that more and more. I was very surprised at the number of students that were out there. Since then, I've been teaching at the Los Rios Community Colleges here locally. And as I talk about ethnographic field work in my classes, I often have students come up to me and announce that they're homeless. And then in some cases ask for some help or suggestions on what they can do. Additionally, in that time period, of course, I ran into untreated mental illness, and really it was not just mental illness, it was chronic illness too. There were lots of people simply suffering out there with mental and chronic illnesses that were untreated. Their afflictions were across a wide variety of things, and they were minor all the way to severe. Some very severe cases I ran into, both of chronic and mental illness. Things that wouldn't be a problem for a housed person with insurance are really a severe problem for individuals when it's left untreated and they have no home. Often due to lack of services and understanding on their part of how to access any services that are there, they often spiral into a loss of a further affiliation with jobs, with family, and even, of course, with society. And then their problems tend to compound by the use of self-medication techniques, and often that leads to a fall into addiction. As I went through this period in my combined ethnographic observations, analysis of the benefits of a local advocacy organization I was working with that was mentoring the camps, which were and are illegal in Sacramento County, and a comparative review of theory on poverty and homelessness led me to conclude that the homeless experienced not only a loss of basic rights, but more importantly, or just as importantly, a dramatic change in their sense of self and place within society. It became apparent that a loss of self and place was exacerbated by issues contributing to and experienced during their homelessness. Moreover, as has been well documented, by anthropologist Lyon Callow, who studied homelessness in Northampton, Massachusetts. The public perception of the emotional, medical, legal, and economic issues leads to a stigmatization of homelessness by the general population, as we all know, but also by the social service providers and the governmental agencies empowered to support them. In other words, we don't really understand some of their needs as well as we think we do. Once they're branded as homeless and further branded as pathological or deviant members of society, they find themselves in the sort of a de facto condition of second-class citizenship. And the process of stigmatizing the homeless also contributes to their being ostracized by the greater community. When they experience this loss of rights, including the ability to act on their own behalf, the process strips them of the very social and political agency that could be utilized to help remedy their situation or their homeless condition. I want to just mention something I found in my research that's always stuck with me. It was some writing by an Italian scholar, Giorgio Agamben, who calls the homeless existence the bare life. And he further defines that as a life of mere necessity, mere physical existence. And that's really what, as I read that, at the same time that I was going out there and spending time with the camps with people, there was community in the camps. There was some joy of having fellow community members, but it was really a bare existence. It was not satisfactory at all. It's often argued that the minimal existence of the homeless is worse than the bare life, that it precludes most normal and social interaction in society, and thereby has the effect of damaging the self of many homeless individuals. In the words of Samira Kawash, a Stanford University economist, the war on homelessness must also be seen as a mechanism for constituting and securing a public, establishing the boundaries of inclusion, and producing an abject body against which the proper public body of the citizen can stand. That really stuck with me too. The homeless in Sacramento experience many acts of exclusion, such as exclusion not just from a home, but from public restrooms, from public institutions, and from places of business. When establishing boundaries that protect the sensitivities of the general public, these exclusionary actions do little to help homeless people. In fact, the acts of debarment from public places and denial of normal human functions, such as the opportunity to sit down, to sleep, or to relieve themselves, restrict their rights and further alters their sense of self. Think of it. I mean, imagine no home. That's one thing. Now imagine no shower for days at a time. And finally, imagine no toilet. What do you do? It's difficult for those of us that are housed and that possess a sense, a healthy sense of self-worth, to really get a handle on this, to understand what the homeless are up against on a daily basis. Yet many homeless, if given the opportunity, can speak very clearly about this. I want to read you a brief statement from one of my collaborators, one of my homeless collaborators that I'll call Jim. I'm just going to read part of this, but let me give you a few of his words. Jim said, "The hardest part about being homeless in America is accepting that one has not had success in a country known for its success. Accepting the impermanence of having to move every morning, not having a home and not being somewhere for a while, just the acceptance of feeling like a loser, a weakling. Whether it's true or not, that is how you're made to feel when you're homeless. We are cast aside. Fear makes us do that. You're just minding your own business, and here come the rangers forcing you to move. Then it rains, and your little home is flooded. Jim goes on to say, once it happened, though, his becoming homeless, I thought I was going to die. I would literally cease to be. I had episodes where I couldn't speak, and I suffered a stroke. I discovered that I was all alone. My family members didn't care for me that much. They said, good luck. And I shut down emotionally. You kind of go into shock. I was dealing with my mother's illness and her passing away, trying to help, but the grief, the anger, and the denial. The house I had grown up in was up for grabs. My personal property went to relatives. I didn't have any children. I'm the family oddball, the free spirit. As the summer progressed that year, Jim started to fit into the camp a little better. He got over that original shock of being there and being homeless. One day, after a number of weeks in the camps, he stepped forward and said he wanted to run in their elections, their self-governance elections within these camps, to become an elder, part of their self-governance system. He did that. He was elected. I don't know if he was the greatest elder they ever had, but he did a good job. And it started building a sense of self within Tim, or Jim. He also took on duties of a job that he self-titled as the sanitation technician for the community, and he built and maintained a porta potty system. He personally constructed it, designed it, constructed it, and implemented it, and then he maintained it. Several months later, the advocacy organization I was working with while I did my research was called, and still is, Safe Ground Sacramento, was approached by Legal Services of Northern California and a special rapporteur for the UN, Katerina de Albuquerque. She was an expert on human rights and especially on access to clean water and sanitation. We arranged an interview with the homeless camp residents previously, and that included Jim. And Jim explained to her, I'm not going to read the quote this time, it'll be in the written report I give to you that you publish. But Jim went on to explain to her in detail how he basically maintained the porta potty, bagging everything up, the human waste, double bagging it, triple bagging it, putting it in a basket on his bicycle, could be 50 pounds worth, believe me, at a time, and riding a mile and a half to 2 miles to where he put it into a sanitation system, a toilet, in a public park somewhere, flushed it, then bagged the bags and got rid of them into the trash system. Her reaction as a special rapporteur was to be astounded. She was not just in the United States to look at access to clean water and sanitation in the homeless community. She had come to the United States after looking at the same thing in many other parts of the world to look at Native American reservations, and she did that. But when she found out what was going on in the homeless community, she expanded her research to include that. And she personally told me, and there's some published reports that are included in what I write up, she personally told me it was worse than what she saw in many third world countries. It horrified her that he had to do this. She saw great value in it for him and for the community that someone stepped up and was doing it. But she was shocked. So shocked that she broke with tradition and wrote the mayor of Sacramento complaining about what was going on rather than going through the appropriate channels through the State Department and everything. She went direct. Well, what is going on in Sacramento as it relates to that? Well, in Sacramento, most public restrooms are in public parks, and they're either locked after 5 p.m. or they're permanently locked. So if you have no home, and you're not allowed in businesses, and the park bathrooms are locked, you have no bathroom. The reason given by local authorities is normally funding issues, sometimes security. They've also decommissioned lots of water drinking fountains. Either that or they've made them hard to fill a bottle in. Purposely modified them so they can't be used by certain groups of people. These situations that we're talking about, I'm only talking about here now to illustrate further what we do, what mistakes we make that just further destroy the sense of self-worth, the sense of self, and lead people to self-blame, and even to the extreme of self-loathing in some cases when they're homeless. I did speak with Jim again because as he took on this task, no matter how terrible it sounds to you and me, he started to kind of come back as a human, as an individual. He saw value in himself and his life, and the sense of self started to grow again. I spoke with him again several months into that, and here's what he said. He said the greater lesson is that financial ruin is not so bad. I realize that life goes on. Being homeless hasn't been the end of the world. I'm not dead. I'm alive. I have courage to face what lies ahead. I have a new job opportunity, the possibility of a house manager position. I'm sorry, I lost my place there. I have a new opportunity, the possibility of a house manager position. I'm over the horrible depression I had when I first came here. I realize I'm worth having a better life, a hopeful life. The camp community got me out of my shell. Who would have an idea like Safe Ground or Loaves and Fishes? It's a beautiful thing. My depression is gone. I have friends. I am happy. Jim was regaining his sense of self-value as a person, and it was through the community of the people in the illegal camps. He did accept the position as house manager. And there's some important points in this story that I just want to go back over real quickly. He came to the camps at a low point in his life. He felt he was a damaged person. He blamed himself. But in the camp community, he gained that sense of self and developed some personal agency. He stepped forward and he supported his homeless neighbors, things that he didn't think he could do. He couldn't even talk at first. There's more about Jim that's important. He had refused to declare himself mentally incompetent to qualify for certain programs. He wasn't mentally incompetent. He may have had some issues, but he was not mentally incompetent. He was very bright. It was the simple act of joining a community, reminds me of Benedict Anderson's imagined communities, that helped him. He simply moved forward once he got around other people and felt acceptance by other people. By that simple act of joining the community, albeit an illegal one along the American River, this homeless man, Jim, who vowed he would never go indoors, one of those folks that we run into that says, I'll never go indoors. I like it out here under the stars. He did go indoors. He went indoors the first opportunity he got after kind of regaining his spirit. He was able to assume a position then of authority as a house manager, a happy and productive citizen. He later accepted a position providing personal care to a fellow formerly homeless friend suffering from cancer. And then he got a job at the same time working at the local food bank and worked there for the next 2 years. The story doesn't end there, unfortunately. He had a great 3 or 4 years indoors. And then he succumbed, eventually passed away, to some undiagnosed cancer that he hadn't been treated for. Something that stayed with him even after he went indoors. But I talked to him a lot in his last days, and he felt that what he had lived through in those last 3 or 4 years, coming indoors and regaining his sense of self, becoming productive, made it almost worth it. As we've heard here today from others, in the last few years, HUD has established directives for a housing first model as a top priority. Tom really ran through the principles of housing first really well. I would just say, from my perspective, the emphasis of housing first is to minimize the time spent in homelessness by first placing people quickly and directly into permanent housing, and secondly, coordinating access for services they need. I realize I'm simplifying it there. My organization that I've mentioned before, I'm sorry I keep forgetting to switch these. I'll stop for a minute. There's Tim as he first came to the camp. That's one of the camps. By the way, all camp communities had a name. This was Sherwood Forest. It's very close to here, actually, or close to downtown, along the American River. This is Tim 6 months later at a news conference where he's reconstructed his porta potty system and is demonstrating it and making a speech to the press. He looks different, he feels different, and he acts different. Sense of self has been regained by being part of a community. Okay, let me catch up with myself now. My organization that I mentioned before, First Step Communities, along with others locally, including the leadership of Sacramento Steps Forward and other members of the Continuum of Care, agree with the direction that HUD has stated, making housing first a priority model. But it's got to be acknowledged, it must be acknowledged, however, that a persistent and troublesome gap exists in the ability to secure enough funding to produce sufficient permanent housing that's affordable and supportive for the homeless population and the size of that population. Simply said, there isn't enough funding for enough affordable housing. And we've also got the situation that there's lots of housed people that are struggling because of lack of affordable housing, spending far too much of their income just to pay a rent, and maybe having to double or triple up in order to get that rent paid. As mentioned earlier too, studies have repeatedly shown that it's less expensive to house the homeless than it is to implement mitigation measures on the streets, in prisons, in hospitals, or through the criminal justice system. So how then do we tackle these issues of the ongoing gap in the availability of affordable housing and the need level in the homeless community? As we took a look at that at First Step Communities, we came up with several conclusions. First, we needed to design an interim housing and services solution that could be implemented through a public-private partnership, a collaborative effort with the city and or county of Sacramento. We knew from the past that efforts at a legalized sanctioned tent encampment was not capturing the political will locally, and it really wasn't going to effectively address some of the needs we had identified for the type of structured shelter, triage, and service environment that we felt were necessary to help people regain that sense of self we've been talking about. We looked at everything. We looked at FEMA trailers, tough sheds, refurbished storage containers, refurbished hotels and motels, and eventually we kind of stumbled onto the tiny house movement that was spreading across the United States. It's part of that changing conception of what a home is that's been talked about earlier. So we decided to see what others were doing. We looked at some best practices for tiny homes, made a trip up to Eugene in Portland, Oregon. Eugene has Opportunity Village. Opportunity Village in Eugene is fairly small, and it was done on a very low budget, but was done with a public-private partnership. It's run by a nonprofit, coordinated with the city. Houses 30, 40 people. They don't have a lot of services, but they have some. And it's very successful. It's so successful that Eugene has just launched a second effort to build Emerald Village, which will be tiny homes that are permanent supportive housing. And they're even toying in the back of their mind with making some of these tiny home villages, like Emerald Village, ownership, some kind of cooperative ownership type program. In Portland is Dignity Village. Dignity Village has been there for over 10 years. It's run on a different model. It's run on a model of self-governance. There really isn't a nonprofit helping it. The nonprofit that exists is run by the residents. And there's a lot of mistakes made, from my perspective, and not to be critical, in Dignity Village. For one thing, it was put miles out of downtown, miles away from services, and the service providers don't want to come out there. People were happy that were living there. And whether it was permanent or temporary was hard to tell, because many of the people had been up there up to 5 years and no one was asking them to leave. Traveling on up to Olympia in Seattle, in Washington. In Olympia, we found Coyote Village, which you see there. Coyote Village is permanent support of tiny homes. With services, they have a community center similar to the one I'm going to describe that we're interested in building. It's run by a nonprofit. The average time that people stay there is about 2.5 years, even though it's permanent supportive housing. After several years, many of the residents are ready to move on to something a little larger. Although we were invited into the tiny homes of some people who had decorated these homes better than I've seen some full-size homes decorated, and were very proud of their home and never intended to move, and that was just fine with the program. That was Dignity Village. Every cabin there was different. And the residents were allowed to modify them, as you can see by the one on the left. Put a personal touch on it. This was Opportunity Village, and most of the cabins there were like the ones on the left or in the middle, but they were experimenting with some mobile ones. I think they had a group from University of California, Berkeley, donate that one to them as part of sort of a project to create a tiny home on wheels. I haven't mentioned Community First in Austin, Texas yet. This is a very different model. It's tiny homes, but it's four levels of homes. They start with a level that's like a tent cabin where canvas is stretched across a wooden sort of framework. They move up to a tiny home similar to the cabins that I'm going to talk about in a minute that we want to build. Then they have donated section of the territory or the community covered with fifth wheels. And finally, they have their top of the line, the park home, which is a 400 square foot tiny home. All of their homes are permanent. All of them are rentals at different levels. They have 25 acres. They intend on the first 25 acres to put about 250 people, and they have just bought another 25 acres. Let me fast forward here a bit and talk about what we are proposing in Sacramento. And we're proposing this because even though we agree with the concept of housing first and permanent housing, again, there's a gap, and that gap has to be addressed. In Sacramento, a recent study showed that we average one homeless death a week year-round and have for the last 10 years. We need to find something to close the gap and to give people shelter now. And we've designed a program of tiny homes, and it's kind of based on housing first principles. We want to lease a piece of publicly owned land and build sleeping cabins like this on it. This particular sleeping cabin design is just one of many that we have. This one is 120 square feet, has room for a bed, chest of drawers, table and chairs, has two windows, a heater that runs off the solar power, and a fan that can push and pull air in and out to kind of control the heat in the summer. We found when we looked into this that we could build a tiny home, solar powered tiny home off the grid for under $10,000. And then we went, and I was working with SafeGround at the time, we went to Habitat for Humanity, explained our design, explained the costs we'd come up with, and they reworked it, improved the energy efficiency, and we built a prototype with them for $6,000. Extremely well insulated, extremely fire retardant. This is the heart of our community proposal. It's the community center where all the communal facilities are, the restrooms, the showers, the laundries, the dining areas, the meeting rooms for bringing in training classes or counseling. And it also has associated with it a medical clinic. And we have a partner, WellSpace Health, who wants to co-locate with us at no expense to us, really, and provide primary health care and mental health counseling, and for cases that are too severe, referrals to other parts of their overall health care system. The community center and medical clinic that you see here is about 5,500 square feet as we've currently designed it. It can be built in a way that's aesthetically appealing to the greater neighborhood, help us deal with a little NIMBYism perhaps, for about $750,000. The other thing about our design of these cabins in this community center with a medical clinic is that it's on a piece of public land that we would lease, and the cabins are completely transportable. So if you guys tell me 5-10 years down the road, we've got enough affordable housing, it's not needed in this particular area anymore, we can pick up the cabins and transport them to where they are needed, some other area in the region, and we can give the land back to the city or county with a medical clinic and a community center. It's a win-win proposal, at least I think it is, and I'm getting some pretty good reception to it. The community that we're designing is limited to 100 people at a time. That's done purposely. We don't want to create a centralized solution and suddenly have 1,000 people in one location. Rather, it can be replicated quite easily and inexpensively in different parts of a region. The sleeping cabins offer privacy and dignity. We want to target a 6 to 12 month residency. We don't fit the old transitional model. We don't fit any model. We're trying to create something kind of new to help fill this gap. There would be caseworkers. Each individual would create, working with caseworkers, would be able to create an individual plan which included healthcare, classes, training, a work assignment within the community, and some counseling. If they have pets, there's a kennel. They can keep their pet with them at night, but when they're busy on a work assignment or going to appointments, the kennel which would be manned by other residents of the community, would take care of their pet. And each one would develop an individualized exit strategy. What is it that they need to work towards? Something they and their caseworker can determine and keep modifying as they go along. Let's picture kind of a drawing of the floor plan. One other thing I want to mention about this, and I'll try to move quickly so we can get to the questions. We envision this as not just a community, but a specialized community. We really look at it as a healing community. It's rather than allowing people to stay on the streets or fight their way in and out of shelters while they wait for affordable housing, we're proposing putting together a special healing community like this. It's the application of community as a methodology, providing help to those individuals who've lost their sense of self-worth, those that are living that bare life we spoke of, a way that they can work together and individually with their caseworker to try to turn that around as they wait for us to provide more affordable housing. In a healing community, just as in kinship, fraternities, or small villages, cultural elements transmit affiliation, learning, and healing. The community will soon form its own identity, and culture will foster healing and growth. The community programs will soon foster stories, legacies, rituals, traditions, delivering the message of change, what's possible, to ongoing generations of participants, guiding them through growth, recovery, and transformation as they slowly re-engage with society. If we're to implement a homeless policy in the Sacramento region, a comprehensive one, we need to address this gap I spoke of between the level of need and the amount of affordable housing. It's only through addressing this gap that we'll start to lower the number of unsheltered homeless and reduce the disproportionately high number of early deaths that we have been experiencing. Our community designs are all about community. All of these, doesn't show it in this picture, all of these little tiny homes would have porches and they'd be arranged in a way that fosters a sort of a community spirit. All of our services would be provided by collaborative partnerships. We don't want to reinvent anything. There's plenty of expertise here already. And we can build a community for 100. One estimate is 2.5 million. You can cut that in half if we cut out a lot of amenities. It all depends on the size of the piece of land and if we go to that full capacity of 100. The combination of tiny homes in a healing community model with the provision of collaborative medical and triage services addresses the gap in the most cost-effective and based on our best practice studies, successful manner that we've been able to come up with. It's not a total solution to homelessness, and it's not meant to be, but rather a major component of a larger integrated solution. It plays a role. It fills the gap. We're talking about housing first principles, taking them and applying them to an emergency situation where we simply do not have enough affordable housing. It can be considered temporary, a temporary community facility that can be moved when no longer necessary, as mentioned before, to another neighborhood where it may be needed, leaving a community center and medical clinic where the community can continue to benefit from it. Thank you.
All right, I can hear the audience is already bubbling up with questions. I'm going to ask all participants to take the seats to my right. And we will be up here on the stage with one microphone, and Karin and Ornelli will be walking around bringing the microphone to you if you have a question to ask.
Well, my name is Beth Gashow. I'm actually a legislative staff with Senator Liu. So just come here to represent. I'm just wondering, are there any other legislative staff here today? No. Wow.
There have been.
I know Alan's staff was here, right? But
is your microphone on?
I just tested it. It seems like it is. Okay, working. Probably very quiet.
I can hear you very well. Yes. I'm right here, so.
Absolutely. I just have two questions. One was for Stephen. If you could please, I missed out on who you were targeting in terms of age range and all of that within your particular program, and if families were also targeted within that. I just didn't know who was a part of that. I have a question for, just a general one as well, follow-up. What, on the policy side, what do you think could be done to incentivize the host model, I think, for the general public, if there's a way to do that, that to allow us to use the resources that we already have, the houses that already exist, and the space that we can make use of within our own communities. And I had one more, also regarding a general one, not directed to anyone, regarding the ethnic makeup and cultural makeup of the homeless situation. You know, what are we seeing? What are the trends that we're seeing at the moment with that regards? And regarding data, obviously there's a big push for disaggregated data for subgroups and ethnicities. What has been your experience with that and, you know, in all of that within your respective areas?
Okay, I can respond at least to the first part of that. Our target with our first community is really the most vulnerable. We're looking at chronic and other of the most vulnerable. We'll try to establish a vulnerability index, and that'll be part of the intake system. But we've designed our community to be replicable. We purposely designed it at no more than 100, but we realized that doesn't take care of a lot of different groups, and we can't necessarily mix certain groups. So we've talked about altering the model. We've had some interest from Sacramento City Council members, not only for communities like this for the most vulnerable, but for families and families with children. I've had people from the Sheriff's Department approach me about early release parolees that they could set up a center like this for. Location, location, location will be the issue. And I've even had discussions with other groups about, you know, could we build a appropriate size for transitional age youth. So I think as long as we're not mixing groups that shouldn't be mixed, I think we can really target different groups. And that's one of the things we tried to build in.
Yeah, in terms of host homes, you know, thinking about the low vacancy rates we have in so many of our communities, particularly in urban communities, you know, thinking about how can we make sure we're using what we do have as efficiently as possible, I think this makes a lot of sense. I think the best way to incentivize it is to fund it and also to incorporate it as a strategy in our plans. So if we have, you know, thinking about how we're coordinating as a state and creating plans around addressing homelessness to make sure that there are explicit models that are targeted toward youth, just recognizing that they're a distinct and unique population and that what works for, you know, a chronically homeless older adult may not be the same model for youth. So through, I think, our funding and through our planning efforts, we can, like, uplift the visibility of this as a model and, yeah, help it come to light. So thank you. Oh, and also in terms of, like, representation around, like, who makes up the homeless community, I'm sure folks have thoughts about this. I know that nationally you see overrepresentation of African American and Native American folks experiencing homelessness. Also, LGBTQ, both youth and adults and seniors tend to be overrepresented among people experiencing homelessness. So thinking about, you know, societal and institutionalized racism, sexism, homophobia, and transphobia, things like that. It's hugely impactful.
Mm-hmm. Unless do you have something more to say about it?
I'm going to assume that Tom is probably closer to the recent data than I am, but in the local homeless censuses that I was involved in around the turn of the millennium, what I found really striking was the absence of immigrants in the homeless population, that the people that I met tended to be native-born Americans, black, white, Chicano, Native American, not Latinos, not Asians, not people who have sort of come in since 1965. And I always attributed that to strong family structures on the one hand and also a lower standard of housing coming into this country on the other hand, so that you have people who don't perceive a studio apartment or a one-bedroom apartment as being inappropriate for a family of five or 10 people, which in most of the world is actually, you know, quite prevalent and not abnormal at all. So, you know, even though immigrant groups obviously suffer poverty, you know, at a higher rate than native-born Americans for the most part, that was my perception, but I don't know. Perhaps it's changed in the last 15 years, especially with the increase in immigration.
Yeah, no, what was already said is basically what's true, is that people of color are overrepresented in the population. I mean, so much of that varies across the country just as a function of the underlying population. In a place like Philadelphia, where there's a fairly, where African Americans constitute a fairly high proportion of the population, you might have 70-80% of people in shelter who are African American. In Boston, where it's a little bit different, the majority of folks who are using shelter are white. It's interesting, the research that's been done on this has actually shown that Hispanic and Latinos are actually underrepresented in the homeless population, sort of for the reason that, some of the reasons that Jason was mentioning, although there's some evidence more recently that that's no longer the case. But in general, people of color are overrepresented.
Yes, assimilation is can be a two-way street, and as people become more American, I would expect them to become more prevalently homeless.
Let me add a word to that. If I could add just a word, I don't disagree with any of the numbers that people have quoted and seen, but I did find all ethnicities when I was in the field, and in some cases that one camp I mentioned, which was parolees, was all Latino. They called themselves La Familia, and it was surprising to a lot of people that there were camps of all one ethnicity out there. And I did find a few immigrants. Now, not many, but a few. We had some Russian immigrants and a few other groups represented who had come over here and very quickly fallen into homelessness. Not very many, but I did see some.
That's certainly the case. I'm only speaking on a statistical level. You meet every kind of person homeless in California. I've met people from Cuba, which is quite ironic.
Hi, I'm Julia Flower MacCannell, and I'm a professor at UC Irvine. My question is, is there any kind of linkage ever made? You talked about Philadelphia and all the homeless people in Philadelphia, and yet I know that in Philadelphia itself, in North Philadelphia, there's thousands and thousands of houses that are vacant. And nobody's, you know, they're derelict, except for a few people like, what was her name, Lily Ye, who made this village for the arts and humanities that created this place for young people to come and get education and everything in the middle of that by buying these houses at $1 a piece from the city and renovating them and using the community to build everything. There's a lot of these things in cities, these vacant things, and yet why are there so many homeless? I mean, I still don't understand. I know it's all real estate interests and everything else, but it makes me angry. I'm sorry.
Before opening it up to other participants, I wanted to mention one of our local heroes in the homelessness movement, G.P. Bailey, is the minstrel, and he actually recorded an entire album called Homeless People, Empty Houses during the Great Recession, which was entirely on that theme. America, America, you really make no sense, where the houses are all empty and the people live in tents. So this is not, you're not the first person to make this observation. I don't have anything else to say about it, except GP is great and I should have invited him here to play a couple of songs today. Does anybody want to take a crack at that? Maybe we'll Steve first.
Just one very quick word about that. That is the case here in Sacramento. It's been pointed out by many people that there's lots of vacant homes, lots of vacant buildings, and lots of people on the streets. Why? When I look at it and compare it to the program we're trying to do, it's actually less expensive for us on an interim solution to build the tiny homes. But when I look at a way to get more affordable housing out there quickly, it makes sense to me to take a look at that.
Yeah, well, I appreciate your anger around that issue. I think that we all share it up here too. And why? Because the interests of people experiencing homelessness are not very well represented. So, you know, yeah. But thank you for bringing it up.
Do you want to add something, Tom?
No, I mean, the only thing I would say is that I think it just kind of underscores a point that I think has been a theme throughout a lot of our remarks, is that there's not, I mean, this is, we've got to think creatively and have a multifaceted approach to addressing this, and everything should be on the table. And I think we've heard some ideas that are a little bit outside of the box from host families and sort of tiny homes, and I mean, all of these things have to be part of it.
And you know, of course, I think the perception of waste or things that are not really in use that could be used to house people extends beyond just housing and homes. If you think about it, the you know, city of Sacramento does have apparently the capacity to operate an illegal campground for 1,000 or more people every night, which is actually a substantial amount of urban land, which is valuable. So we've already given over a lot of unused, abandoned, or underused space to the use of homelessness. And I would say that we're not very happy with the way that's playing out in reality. But it is the reality that that homeless people, in creating their campsites, are taking over, you know, generally public urban land that could potentially be used for another purpose, just as vacant, abandoned houses could potentially be refurbished to house the homeless. Another question?
I think the one thing that have to be understood is that homelessness is not a issue of housing. Homelessness is a mental situation and political organization. And if you help people, you don't need big houses and community center to help people. You can have just a small a small little outdoor space, and you can do that. The problem is that there is the idea that you can invest in housing and turn it and really work with the young people, work with the old people, because the social issue is the issue. It's the fact that we take them out of society and we assume that they are a failure, and in the United States, everybody that doesn't succeed, it's his fault, so to speak. That's the problem. But to build new houses, just tiny houses, big houses, all this on the land, this is not the solution. This is just disregarding the land once again and thinking that the only way to live is in one tiny little house with a little piece around it, not in communal work. And yes, it's cheaper from the private ownership, but it's not cheaper from if we look at that in the entire situation. And I think this is where we have to work in the political system, we have to have public awareness, we have to work in the school, everybody. That's where we have to put our time into, not in building new buildings. We have so much building in the United States, it's unbelievable. New York, Chicago, Philadelphia, Berkeley, San Francisco, they have abandoned places, abandoned areas, factories that can turn immediately into housing. This is where the money is, not in building little houses on the hillside.
Okay, I'm not sure exactly what the question is, but okay. Yeah, but just in response to that, you know, I think that there's a housing shortage in California, and that's widely perceived. So, and the fact that there might be space that's available that isn't currently used as housing, whether we're talking about vacant, abandoned buildings or any number of other possibilities that places where people could live. It's just because that isn't really in the inventory of what we can say today is housing, I guess, is why we have a housing shortage, or maybe not. I don't really know. If maybe Susie has an answer to this, because I understand, my understanding is that there really aren't enough housing units available.
So we've had an appreciable loss in our stable housing for people who are homeless. It used to be that we would build public housing. Now public housing is being privatized and potentially mortgaged off through a program called RAD. Our next form of stable housing, it was project-based Section 8. Not a lot of that is being built. And then the next one up is the vouchering that I was talking about, where someone who is homeless gets a voucher and then they need to run around trying to find a landlord. And good luck with that. You know, a lot of people have success, other people do not. And it's been completely privatized. That is a private system, very similar to what vouchers were to education that people were trying to push. And then now the answer, and I can only speak for large urban centers like Los Angeles, but the answer seems to be to go to private developers who want to build a lot of luxury housing and then put like a tiny strip of what they call affordable housing on that, and to get a lot of money from the city or the county or some government entity in order to do that, to build what they call affordable housing. Now, we found in Los Angeles that, I'll give you an example. There was a developer who came and wanted to build senior housing. 27 units were affordable for seniors. And I think they got about $6 or $7 million from the city in order to build these units. Well, I tried to move a senior in a foreclosed home. It wasn't her home, she was a renter, but thankfully we have a moratorium on evictions in Los Angeles, so she wasn't evicted. We were able to keep her in her housing for 9 months. When we moved her over to the senior housing, what I noticed about the application was that they actually excluded anyone who had been homeless for the previous 3 years. So you had to actually, and this is in effect now, although we are moving right now. I'd love to have a statewide law, by the way. But we are moving right now for the city of Los Angeles to make this illegal. So if you're going to take money from the city, you can't require 3 years of permanent rental history with no gaps. So, I mean, I took this to a council, even the council members didn't know this. I took this to a council member, it was in his district. He had approved this project. And I said, look at this. And he like literally pushed his chair away from the table and said, not only are they saying you can't be currently homeless, but they're saying that you can't have been homeless in the last 3 years. So this is what we're seeing. And so there's a lot of, you know, coming to get money from the government. But as I said, sort of in my speech, there's no oversight. So there's no government oversight. There isn't anything regulating that. So money flows out of the government, and then they kind of just do what they want. I mean, I don't want to, I know there are wonderful, wonderful nonprofits here in Sacramento, but there are also nonprofits who are just not doing the job, or they're mistreating people, or they're doing all kinds of things, and they don't feel like there needs to be oversight. They don't feel like there needs to be regulations, but they really do, because we're basically sending people out there, and a lot of them are being mistreated, and they just don't have a voice in that process, and people are, you know, sort of in the community, in the service community, are afraid to speak out against other, you know, service organizations that are mistreating people or not doing their job. So we're speaking out in Los Angeles, but this is sort of the model. So we've gone from totally public to now completely privatized. And I think that a lot of these developers have created the situation that we're in now by raising rents. And so you don't go back to the person or the entity that created the problem to fix it.
And I just want to go back to the first point that you raised, which is that there's this social dimension as well as a housing dimension to homelessness. And I think every speaker actually has spoken to that in different ways. And I would also argue that the social dimension in something like Housing First or a tiny home model or even host housing, they're, the part of it is programs, right? Bringing people in who know what to do, counselors, various kinds of helpers to get you education, get you health care, et cetera. That's a kind of connectedness. But there's also a really basic that you really aren't able to participate in society unless you have a place where you're allowed to be, and B, and this is maybe a little more uncomfortable for progressives and liberals to wrap their minds around, but a place that you can exclude other people from, because that is really the basic definition of a home, is your private space. So, and I think that if you don't have that foundation as an individual of having just a retreat, I would call it a retreat more than a home, a place you can go to, be away from people. Homeless people don't have that for the most part if they're living on the streets. And when you don't have that basic sense of a place that you can go, that you can always go, that you can retreat to, it's really, really hard to build any other kind of social connectedness, because connection to society is something that chases you around everywhere and you're trying to avoid it. Anyone have anything to add, or should we take another? Yeah, we're getting close to time, so maybe another question or two. Yeah, let's hear from the purplish shirt right there. Oh, you have another one too. Oh, I didn't see you. I'm sorry.
My name's Chris. I work for the California State Association of Counties on housing and land use planning, and it's sort of interesting. We've kind of divided it up where we talk about planning the communities, and we have other people that work on the health and human services side of things. And something that's been an interesting question to me is when we're talking about the Housing First model, a rationale you're constantly hearing is the cost offsets or the cost savings. But I think the fundamental problem is, do those savings accrue to the same people that are incurring the cost? So the example, I think, in Los Angeles of the city, right? So savings in incarceration going to go to the county. Savings in mental health and human services are going to go to the county and the state and federal government. So what sort of models and solutions are being worked out that kind of address that fundamental disconnection, I guess?
I didn't plant that question, but it's exactly the thing that's been troubling me. Who wants to? Here.
I mean, yeah, that's exactly right. And I think the cost argument has been incredibly successful in marshaling political will to support the expansion of these projects, right? Whether those savings actually materialize and to whom they accrue is kind of a different question, and one that I don't think is fully addressed. What's interesting, though, is if you look at across all these studies, the biggest savings are always to the healthcare system, right? Whether it be primarily from psychiatric hospitalization and also inpatient hospitalization for physical health problems, which is why I think that the strategy of harnessing some of those resources that are in the healthcare system to fund forms of assistance that can either help people get into housing or to help them maintain tenancy is probably the best avenue that we can go to. And if you think about Medicaid is an entitlement program, so folks who are eligible for Medicaid, they're going to get on Medicaid, they're going to get services. And so I think that's where a lot of momentum is going, is focusing specifically on Medicaid. You know, they've basically said that they're not going to pay for capital dollars to actually pay to construct housing or to pay for rent, but there are other things that I think that they can do to help people get into housing and to help maintain tenancy. So I think, you know, the cost argument is a really politically effective one, but I also think to a certain extent it's made at our own peril, insofar as if that's what you hang your hat on and it doesn't materialize, then what are you left with? And I also think, you know, when we think about this, you know, when we talk about new cancer treatments, we don't require new cancer treatments to save money to be deemed worthwhile to do. So it's kind of an interesting thing when you think about it. We would ask that a social program generate cost savings in order for it to be worthwhile to do. So it's also an ideological question as well for me. But it is very effective from a political standpoint of view, and I think it's the only thing that has generated political will to invest in some of these programs.
and you know, also all of us, or I think most of us here, understand the complexities of public finance, meaning that it, you know, even if a hospital is operated by the same county that's operating a Department of Social Services, that spending by the Department of Social Services that saves the hospital money doesn't necessarily mean the hospital is going to pay the Department of Social Services, you know, for what they've done to defray the cost. So I think that's might be the at the county level. I think that's the question, right? When you save money in one place and you say, okay, this program is paying for itself, maybe it isn't. And I think that's definitely a piece of the, that's a piece of the puzzle that's that needs to be worked out.
I would obviously look at it differently because we have statewide legislation going through right now. But I think that's what's so important about the Utah model is that instead of so much, you know, in terms of budgets, governmental budgets, we compartmentalize everything. But there's such a cost savings over time. And I think rather than look at it that way, we just need to look at it as everybody wins. You know, if you have someone who is chronically homeless, it's going to affect Medi-Cal dollars. It's going to affect what the county is spending in county hospitals. It's going to affect the city budget. I think we see with our Housing for Health program that as you're pulling people off the streets in the county, you're also pulling them off in the city. So it's benefiting both the county and the city in terms of that program, even though the county may be paying for more, now the city's going to start kicking in. So it's a C3 program, county, city, and community. And I think, you know, the state, this is why it's so important to have these statewide programs, because all what affects one county also affects the next county over, because people might migrate over to that particular county, and then everything sort of spills over. So I think at a state level, it's really important to say, okay, we're on a housing first model. We're just going to say these are the cost savings, and everybody wins, because you can't go through line item by line item going, okay, we saved this much here, but then we didn't save it here. I mean, you know, Medi-Cal is paying for a lot of the cost for people to be in the hospital, the county has to run its programs. You know, it's just, it's kind of crazy to do that. I know we should do that with environmental products and services. And finally, we realized, you know, fluorescent lights just save money. Let's spend a little more money to put fluorescent lights in, and over time, you have cost savings. And I think that's kind of how we have to look at homelessness.
So we're quite over time now. So what I'm going to suggest is everybody leave who wants to leave, and maybe we can just sort of stay here and talk informally among ourselves, if that's amenable to everyone. Okay. All right. Well, thank you so much for not just coming but staying through the whole thing. Really appreciate it. I hope you've learned a lot. I have. Thank you.